last Sunday night. If you had the opportunity to be here, you know how good they were last Sunday night. They led us in a kickoff to a theme that our high school department has kicked off, and we kind of wanted to permeate the whole church. It's called Advent Conspiracy. And there's 4 points to Advent Conspiracy. All right, worship fully, spend less, give more, love all. And so they kicked that off last Sunday night with music and with message and with more music and with another message. It was terrific. It was an awesome night. And so Milo said, hey, let's have them kick things off this Sunday morning. So since it is the first Sunday of December, I can now rightfully say Merry Christmas. And I hope I don't hear a one of you out in the public arena say Happy Holidays. Okay? All those stores are not making money because of any old holiday. They are making bucket loads of money on the birth of Jesus Christ. So tell them Merry Christmas. All right? All right. That sermon's over. Welcome to... You like that kind of sermon, huh? Yeah, short, sweet, to the point. I got a longer one for you, though, in a few minutes. Welcome to New Hope Church. It's great to have you with us today. If you are a guest today, thank you so very, very much for coming. It is our privilege to have you with us. There are some communication cards in the pew in front of you. We would love for you to fill one out. Put it in the offering bag. We promise not to be an irritant or an annoyance to you, but through the mail, we're going to send you some information that tells you what goes on around New Hope, what we believe, who our staff is, hopefully answer most of your questions, and then if that's not enough and you want to be annoyed, you can call us, okay, and we'll do that, but we'd love to have your information today. Those communication cards are also for the rest of the church family. If you have prayer requests, messages to staff, information that you need us to get to you, please take advantage of those, and we'll try to respond as quickly as we possibly can. A lot of things going on out in the pavilion today, so let me highlight those very, very quickly. Number one, this was short notice, but an email went out, and I think we announced it last week. If you have some used tennis shoes or new tennis shoes that you would like to get to Mexico, drop them off today. So if you didn't know that because you weren't here, didn't read the email, you can go get them and bring them back, all right? But it's pretty time sensitive because we've got a team from our student ministries department that's going to Mexico this coming week. It's their exploratory trip for the Mexico Mission Project, and they try to kind of add a little mission to this project as well. Here's the deal. Prison Fellowship Ministries is engaged in prisons down in Mexico. And the prisons in Mexico have a policy that their inmates cannot leave their cell to attend Bible studies or church services if they don't have shoes. And they do not provide shoes for their inmates. Must be provided by family or friends. And so this got started about 2 years ago. Joni Kolb is the one who kind of lit the fire under this after her first trip to Mexico. And so our group of guys going down would be happy to throw in the back of their vehicle a couple of hundred pairs of shoes and drop off to PF so that they can distribute it in the prison so men can attend their Bible studies. The prisons that they have this relationship with are men-only prisons. So if you have some used tennis shoes, kind of you've been here long enough, you know my view about used stuff. It needs to be usable. In other words, the sole needs to be attached to the rest of the shoe, all right? They shouldn't have holes in them, all right? They may be slightly worn, but they still need to be usable, all right? Otherwise, remember, we're going to worship fully, spend less so we can give more. So go buy a pair of tennis shoes that can be usable, all right? Get them back here before 12:15, and they will go to Mexico this week. Also out there in the pavilion is... Bill Eccles, and you will see Bill out there, and he's the guy who looks like already he's got 40 or 50 pairs of crutches and walkers and canes. And so if you have any of those things and they are not needed anymore or they're not in good service, it's okay. Bring them. These you can bring damaged. They're non-workable. Bring those. You need to bring them today. So go home and bring them back, all right? Because they're going to get put in the back of some trucks and they're going to be delivered to Taft Prison. And the inmates at Taft Prison refurbish all of these. And then through Johnny and friends, they are distributed around the world to those who would not have access to aids for walking and mobility. And they're provided as a gift. All right? So we get to start it. So bring them. All right? They would love to have those. Prison Fellowship is in need of men's clothing. All right? And Gloria Swent, you can contact her. You can also drop clothes off out there today. And there is also a table in the pavilion that has some books stacked up on it. The book is entitled Jesus, Pure and Simple. It was written by Wayne Cadero, the pastor of New Hope Church in Hawaii. And I talked about that in a sermon 7 or 8 months ago. And I told you then it moved into my top 10 all-time of books I've ever read. And I told Harry whenever he could get a really good deal, I would buy a couple of hundred of them from him so that we could provide them for you all here at New Hope Church. So it's kind of the way we do most of our books here. And I haven't done this in several months now, but there's three prices on those books. You pay whichever price meets your need at the moment. It's a $20 book. You can buy it for $10. You can buy it for $5. You can get it for free. Okay? If you're employed, pay $10 for it. If you're employed part-time, pay $5 for it. If you're broke, take one, all right? There's a box out there. There's an envelope. Nancy's going to be out there between services. But part of it's on the honor system. If nobody's there, drop a 10, take a book, all right? That's an honor system. Now, part of my staff's a little nervous about that because a couple of weeks ago, we had another ministry out there doing some things where there was exchange of money and the person manning the table had to use the restroom. Left the stuff there. Somebody took $55 out of it. Okay? Here's the deal. They must have needed it. Okay? If they didn't, then at the end of the service, there's probably time for repentance to take place. Okay? And that's okay. But if you'd let us know you have a need, we'll do our very best to meet that need. But I'm not going to let one bad act stop us from doing what is good and right around here. So it's the honor system still out there, okay? So 10, 5, or free on those particular books. Senior luncheon is this Tuesday, all right? The last one of the year. Gene has got Christmas music prepared for you, all right, for senior luncheon this week. So be a great time to come and get a 55 or older, all right? Some of you who are 60, I'm not old enough. Yes, you are. Yes, you admit it. The sooner you come to acknowledgement, all right? Otherwise, you're in denial, okay? And we have an organization for you, a ministry here on Thursday nights that would meet. So Thursday night, go to Celebrate Recovery, and you would be liberated to come to senior luncheon, all right, on Tuesdays. So they would love to have you for that. I can't wait to get over 60. All right, I can't wait. 60's been ugly, all right? Next Saturday is men's breakfast, all right? Terrence Frazier, a former baseball player. I think I said football on the 8 o'clock service. I watched too much football last night after we got home. Terrific testimony, local guy, and Gene has gone over the top getting Terrence to be here this coming Saturday morning. So men, bring your sons out with you. Enjoy a good breakfast and hear an incredible and stirring testimony. Next Sunday afternoon at 4 o'clock, right here in the sanctuary, our kids are going to be doing their Christmas Nativity musical. These kids have been working for a couple of months now. Dawn, they are ready to go, right? All right, and I hear nothing but good stuff of how great it's going to be. So I understand this is not going to be a long service. This is going to be about 35 minutes, all right? Probably from start to finish, prayer at both ends, all right? About 35 minutes, so you'll have time to go to Denny's for dinner afterwards, all right? So come and join us next Sunday afternoon at 4 o'clock for our children's Christmas musical. Let me share with you a thank you letter that I received. We got here at the church. Dear NHCC, thank you so much for allowing me to share God's word and my heart with you recently. Jesus, is he worth it? We praise God together for the people who publicly responded to God's touch during those services. You continue to minister to me by graciously letting me in when I preach. You were also so very generous to Bob Thomas Ministries. Thank you for the honorarium and the offering. What a blessing. Until next time or until then, God bless you. Much love to you all. Bob Thomas. All right? For those of you who don't remember his name, that's yeah. All right? Just know you know him that way. All right? And he called just to see how everybody was doing yesterday. Some prayer requests. Joe Newby from our 8 o'clock service is at Fresno Community Hospital. I got word which hospital she's in. So she has an irregular heartbeat, and they're trying to get that corrected. So pray for Joe Newby. Judy Heda's son, James, who's been battling stage 4 cancer for a long, long time now, is in the hospital. Difficulty breathing, needs to be on oxygen. So please remember to pray for him. We want to continue to remember to pray for a sister church in Northwest Fresno, and that's North Point. It's been a few weeks. I know they've already had the memorial service for their youth pastor, but the recovery and the comfort is still needed. So continue to pray for them, please, as they gather today. We need to pray for our fellow California citizens down in San Bernardino County. The tragedy of this past week is absolutely horrific. And for those of us as believers in Christ, we have to be very careful that we don't allow our frustration to become anger and our anger to become bitterness. It's hard for us to imagine that in the practice of someone's religion, it would prompt them to do the kind of things that were done to create so much carnage. The Jesus Christ, whose birth we celebrate this month, died for them, rose again from the dead for them, just like he did for you and me. They need to see and hear and watch the love of Christ and the power of God in action. And it's not by a fortress mentality. It's not by anger. It is by caring and loving. It is by meeting the needs of those families who've been devastated. And our prayer should be for those churches and that community, for however God provides opportunity for them to reach out. And so we need to be very cautious during this time. We need to always be careful, but be cautious. Guard our hearts that we don't allow these kind of things to create bitterness and hatred in our hearts. A few extra prayer requests. Debbie Kalusian, it's new in the bulletin this week. Many of you know Debbie and Mike. They visit our church from time to time. They're part of the Calway United Methodist Church. Some of you remember a few years ago, we've shared in worship services with them. We've tried to kind of encourage them. They're in a struggling neighborhood and kind of lost effectiveness of ministry, and there's some new things are kind of happening there, and so we'll be excited to share with you when we have more information. But Debbie has been battling cancer. This is her fourth bout with cancer. It came back again. She'll be in Stanford on the 16th. They're going to do a type of surgery I have never heard of before, and I guess that's why it's being done at Stanford. They are literally going to open her up. I'm a little graphic this morning. They're going to take all of her internal organs and lay them on the table. Okay? They are going to remove the part of the cancer that they can, and then without those organs where they're supposed to be, they are going to radiate that whole area right there, because her organs could not take any more radiation exposure. And so once that's done, then everything will be put back in place, and then she'll go through the recovery. So this is pretty serious. It's different. And so just be praying for them. She loves the Lord, and she's prepared for whatever lies ahead. And several of you know, but Shelly's mom, we really weren't expecting midweek that she would make it to the weekend. You know, she just lost her dad less than 2 months ago. Mom took a really bad turn last weekend. There's a little bit of improvement Friday and Saturday, so I'm home. But just be praying for Betty at this particular time. They would appreciate that so much. So those are a few of the updates that I wanted to share with you. I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward and wait on us this morning as we have our morning tithes and offering. Gentlemen or ladies or both, thank you for coming forward. We got the men crew today. Would you join with me as we pray, and then our student ministries worship team will be back to lead us in worship. Hold on a minute. Do we have a clip back there from women's ministries? You had it before service. Okay, all right, good. If you missed that, Elvis was on the premises last week at New Hope Church, all right? He was sighted, and they got him on film and showed it. So if you missed it, hang around, and they'll show it again before the next service, all right? Let's pray. Father, thanks for life, the life that you so willingly share with us, this life that Father, you not only willingly share with us, you have been pretty persistent in pursuing us until we come to a point we realize this is a life we want to share. So, Father, thank you for that. We come to you today with, Father, a bucket load of need. We live in a world that is crazy. At times, it is extremely ugly. There are things that go on that not only fill our hearts with pain, but, Father, they create pain in the lives of so many. There are churches that are gathered today whose hearts are broken because of the deaths of members of their fellowship who were having a Christmas lunch together connected to their work. There are families who are meeting today making decisions about services they had no idea they would be making a week ago. And, Father, we pray for them. We're kind of long distance from here, but if there are ways that we can be of assistance and help, I pray, Father, that you will give us the leadership as well as the will to follow those opportunities you give. But in the meantime, what we know we can do is pray for our sister churches and that community, that, Father, they will be your light and your salt. They will be your hands of caring. They will be your voice of compassion. And, Father, I pray that instead of fear and darkness ruling the day in San Bernardino County, I pray that the star of Bethlehem will shine brightly. I pray the songs of the angels will be heard. I pray that the witness, Father, of shepherds will be evident to those who are around, that Emmanuel, God, is with us. And we should not run and hide in fear, but we should reach out with love, help, and hope. Thank you for the privilege of giving and sharing today. It's a testimony that you are sufficient to meet our needs. We commit all this to you in the incredible name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Sorry, I'm a little behind. If you brought your Bibles, turn to the second gospel, all right? The gospel of Mark, and find chapter 1, okay? Mark chapter 1. In just a couple of minutes, we're going to read the first 8 verses found in Mark chapter 1. I recently came across a short little story about a pastor who was doing what most pastors do at the end of a service, and he was standing back at the door shaking hands as the members of the congregation left that day. He grabbed one of the men by the hand and kind of pulled him aside, and he was going to get a little confrontational with him. He hadn't seen him in a long time. And the pastor said to this one particular gentleman, he said, you need to join the army of the Lord. And the man replied, Pastor, I'm already part of the Lord's army. And the preacher questioned him. He said, how come I don't see you except Christmas and Easter? And he whispered back to the pastor, Pastor, I'm in the Secret Service. I'm afraid there might be a lot of folks who go by the name of Christian that are actually in the Secret Service. Maybe a lot of us who attend church regularly that outside the confines and the context of the church fellowship would probably be known as members of the Secret Service. You and I are approaching a season. It's called Christmas. It's one of the grandest times of the year. There's something different about this time of year, not because it's December, but because it's Christmas. There's something every year. And you and I, most of us who are gathered here today in churches just like this world, I think we have some important decisions to make at the beginning of this month. And they're not the decisions about the size of our Christmas tree, or what color of ornaments we're going to use this year, or at whose house are we going to have the family celebration. I think all of us need to seriously think about, am I prepared to prepare the way of the Lord? Am I prepared for God to use me? What did I forget to do? I don't really like people behind me. I sit in restaurants with my back to the wall. But God called a particular man for a very specific job, and it's connected
have a group for that, Tim.
Okay, yeah. I'll be there. Do you know what he's up to, Eric? All right, okay, all right.
There's an app for that.
Yeah, probably is. And I think maybe we get the idea that this one guy is the only guy who was called to do what he did for that very first kickoff of Christmas. And my challenge to you today is this. I don't think God called only John the Baptist to be the forerunner of Jesus Christ. And I want to suggest to you this morning that if you are a believer in Jesus Christ, if you have professed Jesus Christ as your Savior and Lord, that you have a privilege of being the forerunner of Christ for this Christmas season. And I want you to think about that this morning. You see, this is the good news about Jesus, the Messiah, the Son of God. It began, as the Scripture tells us, just as Isaiah said it would. In Isaiah chapter 40, verse 3, we have these words, "Look, I am sending my messenger ahead of you, and he will prepare your way. He is a voice that will be shouting in the wilderness." And what's he going to shout? "Make ready for the coming of the Lord." And that coming, that initial first coming, was the first of many other comings of Christ. He was born in a manger in Bethlehem that first Christmas. But it has been Christmas on many other days of the year for 2,000 years ever since then. When he was born in the Apostle Paul's heart on the Damascus Road. When he was born in the heart of Andrew and in Peter. When he was born in the heart of Lydia. When he was born in your heart and yours and yours and yours and yours and mine. That was Christmas Day for us. And now that we have had our Christmas moment, we have the privilege of becoming a John the Baptist to our current culture, to our group of friends, to our family. We have the privilege of being that one voice crying out in a wilderness, "Let's straighten up our act. Let's clean out the garbage in our life. And let's enjoy the life of Christ in us." Let's read Mark chapter 1, verses 1 through 8. It brings the Old Testament and the New Testament together, and it does it very succinctly. Chapter 1, verse 1, Gospel of Mark, it says this: "In the beginning of the gospel about Jesus Christ, the Son of God, it is written in Isaiah the prophet, 'I will send my messenger ahead of you who will prepare your way. It is a voice of one calling in the desert, prepare the way for the Lord, make straight paths for him.' And so John came, baptizing in the desert region." I always find that, I love that. He baptized in a dry place. All right? Right in the, and quite frankly, isn't that what we need when we discover that our life is barren? We need the water of life. So I see this contrast here. And what did he come preaching? A baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. The whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem went out to him. Confessing their sins, they were baptized by him in the Jordan River. Now they decide to tell us a little bit about the food and fashion of John the Baptist. John wore clothing made of camel's hair. I'll be honest, from Josh Banks 2 Christmases ago, I bought a camel hair jacket. I don't think it looks anything like John the Baptist, okay? I think his had a style all of its own. Along with that, he wore a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. You know, there's a lot of people who are on the Daniel plan. I haven't seen anybody yet on John the Baptist plan. Okay. And this was his message. After me will come one more powerful than I, the thongs of whose sandals I'm not worthy to stoop down and untie. I baptize you with water as a symbol of the washing of your sins away, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. I can only baptize you that your sins are forgiven, but when he comes, he's going to baptize you with his presence to come live within your life. You and I have the wonderful privilege of sharing that with others. I was just trying to see what you were up to back there, Mark. All right. Okay. You see, John the Baptist, what I want to challenge you with today is this. Jesus is coming, and we are to prepare the way for his arrival. Some of you are saying, but Tim, he already came. Yeah, but he's coming again. And he's coming again in two ways. One, he's coming again for the final time. But before then, he wants to come again to the heart of your brother or sister who doesn't know him. He wants to come again to the heart of your son or daughter who doesn't know him. He wants to come again to the heart of your neighbor who's never been introduced to him. He wants to come again to the heart of a radical Muslim man or woman who labors under the burden of a vicious religion. I made Siri mad 2 weeks ago. She doesn't talk to me anymore on my phone. I did. Ticked her off. I may never get this crowd back now, all right? The scriptures state something special about the coming of Jesus. Jesus is the one the prophet spoke of. The one to prepare for. Malachi chapter 3, verse 1, last book of the Old Testament, says it this way. Look, I'm going to send my messenger and he'll prepare the way before me. Then the Lord you were seeking will suddenly come to his temple. The messenger of the covenant whom you look for so eagerly, he is surely coming, says the Lord of heaven's armies. Isaiah 43 that Mark quotes in the first chapter says, listen. Malachi said, look. Isaiah says, listen. It's the voice of somebody. And he's shouting. This guy is not a secret agent. He is shouting. I had somebody this morning at the beginning of the service tell me about their son-in-law who's in the secret intelligence. And I said, I've been a part of that group for a long time. Secret intelligence. Thank you, Bob. You got that one. All right. You're the only one. That's right. Okay. You have the same kind of secret intelligence I have. Yeah. All right. But Malachi said, look, Isaiah says, listen, it's the voice of someone shouting, not whispering, shouting, clear the way, open the wilderness, make straight a highway through the wasteland. For what purpose? For our God. Make a way. Let's clear out the debris so folks can discover Jesus for who he is. In 1775, just a few years ago, Daniel Boone. About 9 months ago, I discovered that on channel 259 on Dish Network, they're playing old reruns of Daniel Boone. 6 a.m. in the morning. It's so cool, all right? I love it. Watch those when I was like 7 or 8. But Daniel Boone blazed a trail through the Cumberland Gap. The Cumberland Gap is a notch in the Appalachian Mountains, and it's right where Kentucky, Virginia, and Tennessee intersect. Today, it's known as the Wilderness Road, and it served as a pathway to the western United States. That cracks me up. Because they are about as far east from us as you can get, all right? But in those days, that was the western part of the U.S., and over 300,000 settlers traveled through that gap that Daniel Boone blazed in a period of 35 years. And they made it possible for the establishment of the first settlements in the state of Kentucky, which led to it becoming the 15th United States state. And that was in the year 1792. In the passage today, John the Baptist is talking about another type of road. Not of clearing a path over mountains and rivers, but clearing a path through humanity's selfishness, sin, and its evil. And guys, if you were not convinced before this week that we live in a very evil world, I don't know what else could convince you that evil abounds in this world. And yet, I would suggest to you the evil we have today hasn't yet arrived to the same climax of the evil that existed at the time of the birth of Jesus. When you stop to think about what was going on in the Colosseum, when you stop to think that because of the birth of Jesus, Herod proclaimed that all children 2 years and younger, male children, were to be slaughtered, evil was rampant then, and Jesus came on the scene, and in 33 years, he turned the world upside down. And if he did it then, by a handful of believers sold out to the message of Jesus Christ, can't he do it again? And the issue is not with God. He's the same God then that he is today. The issue is not with him. The issue is going to be with his followers, with us. So how did John make paths straight for the coming of the Messiah? Primary to John's task of preparing the way was the message that he preached. And what was the message of John the Baptist? It was the message of repentance for the forgiveness of sin. That's the first step that you and I must take before we can go out into the world on a daily basis and make straight paths out of crooked ones. We must be engaged in repentance. We must prepare our own hearts with the act of repentance. You see, the need for repentance is essential. And I understand that in 21st century culture, in 21st century church, to toss out a word like repentance sounds a bit antiquated, sounds a little old-fashioned. I mean, that was good for the day of John the Baptist, but really, we've cleaned up our act a lot since then. Really? Really? Have we? And some of you are saying, Tim, remember, we're all members of the church. We've already repented. I want to suggest to you today that there are two types of repentance. First of all, there is the repentance of a sinner who is in need of a Savior. A sinner is everyone who has ever been born on the face of this earth because we're independent of God. And we finally come to a place that we realize, one day I'm going to die. And there's this place called heaven I've heard about. There's this place called hell. Most folks I've talked to over the years, you know what? If they believe in heaven, they also believe in hell. They don't like it. But I mean, if there's one, you kind of got to have the other. And so most folks come to repentance because they realize one day I'm going to die. I got these two options. I don't like one option. And so I want the other option. And that's all the faith we have, is to know that there is a Jesus who was born. It's called Christmas. That man lived for 33 years. He died a cruel death. He rose again from the dead. And because of that, he offers to me a home in a place called heaven if I accept him. And so we repent, and sometimes we're five. That's pretty much all I knew at five about repentance. And sometimes, set by bedsides of 85, 86, 88, 90-year-olds, and about all they can know at that moment is death is imminent, heaven or hell. I believe. It's a thief on a cross. Remember me today. And that brings to us the birth of Jesus into our life. We become a Christian. But then one of the disciples, the one known as the beloved one, the son of Zebedee, not James, but John. John writes in his first letter. And when he sent that letter, who did he send that letter to? Who did John send his letter to? Thank you. to a church. Folks just like you, just like me. And here's what John said in verse 9 of chapter 1 of 1 John. Not the Gospel of John, but 1 John, one of the epistles. And he says this, if you confess your sins, is that what he said? That's not what he said. Yeah, he said if we. So John was included himself. John was also already an appointed apostle of Jesus Christ. He had already, at the time that probably he wrote 1 John, he may have already been attempted to have been killed for his faith. He's definitely a believer. He's already written, he's already preached. And yet John says to the church, including himself, if we confess our sins, then he, God, our Father, our Savior, our Lord, our life, he is willing to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. This is not new birth repentance. This is the need to daily repent because none of us are perfect. This is the need to maintain a healthy relationship with him, to keep very short accounts. It's part of what Jesus meant when he talked to Peter the night of the feet washing event. And Jesus came to Peter and Peter said, Lord, you're my Lord. You cannot wash my feet. No, I won't hear of it. Jesus said to him, whoa, Peter, my friend, if I don't wash your feet, then you have no relationship with me. And he said, then give me a shower. Give me a bath. Wash me from head to toe. And Jesus said, Peter, it's not because your whole life is a mess. But man, you've been traipsing with sandals on your feet through these dirty streets. Your feet are dirty. You and I traipse through a world that is dirty. And there are things in our life that happen after we're a Christian that are not pure, that are not holy, that are not in dependence upon God. And John is saying to the church, confess those things. Don't let there be a buildup of dirt and dust in your life that eventually leads to big problems. Keep short account. Did you not discover? How do I want to say that differently? There were some things I did at 5 and 6. That I didn't do at 25 or 26. And there are some things I didn't do at 55 and 56 that I did at 25 and 26. Would most of you say that's probably true for you as well? Some of that stuff at 5 I didn't know was wrong that I did. But I realized at 25 and 26 it was wrong. So I didn't do it anymore. The same thing is true with us when we become a Christian. When we first become a Christian, there's some junk in our life that we don't realize is in opposition to God. All we want is a relationship with him. We want to know we're going to go to heaven when we die. But day by day, as we discover he now lives in us every moment of every day. Man, are there some times you have to apologize to your wife for some crap you've done that day that annoys her? Does that ever happen in your marriage? Okay, let me ask you this. If you don't apologize, if you don't lay it out on the table, are things a little awkward for a little while? I'm sorry, guys, to pick on you, but it's a whole lot better for me if I pick on you than if I pick on your wives, okay? I've learned that in marriage, okay? And so we learn in this relationship that there are some things that was okay when we first got married, but now that we know each other better, we understand that some of those things that I didn't know were wrong are wrong because they are offensive and hurtful to my wife. Jesus Christ, according to the Bible, he is our bridegroom and we are his bride. And as we grow up in this relationship with him, we will discover there are some things in our lives that we didn't once know were an offense to him. And we need to keep short accounts with him. We need to confess. Before we can prepare the way for Christmas in the world, we must prepare our own hearts. Psalm 51:17 says this, "The sacrifice you desire, O God, is a broken spirit, You will not reject a broken and repentant heart, O God. We often think God will reject us if we don't come to Him all perfect. And yet God says, I rejected the Pharisees who would come to me in their perfection. What I receive joyously is a broken, repentant heart. Do you know who wrote that verse out of the psalm? There's a good chance you'll get the answer right. Yeah, David wrote that one. David wrote that one after he had wrote Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd. He already knew God is a shepherd. And yet David wrote this after what event in his life? Yeah, after the sin of Bathsheba. He's king of Israel. What led to the sin with Bathsheba? He wasn't where he was supposed to be. Often gets in our way sometimes, huh? There are some places we know we ought to stay away from. David should have been out leading his army, but instead he was home and he couldn't sleep that night. And the reason he couldn't sleep that night, I'm pretty confident, is he knew he wasn't where he was supposed to be. And so he goes up for a walk on top of his rooftop. I mean, you know, it's his own rooftop. Yeah, but he wasn't supposed to be there. So he's walking around on his rooftop, and of course his rooftop was higher than everybody else's. He looks down, and there was this beautiful soldier's wife who just knew at that time of night there wouldn't be anybody out to watch her bathe, and so she's taking a bath, and here's the king who wasn't where he was supposed to be, and he sees somebody who thinks nobody is seeing her, and he conceives an idea in his mind, and that thought becomes an action, and then that action becomes a cover-up, and his sin is multiplied. And David, I guess because he's keen, didn't think he needed to repent of it or confess of it. And he grew hard in his heart until one day a prophet of God came to him and he tells him this story. He tells him a story about two other men, you know, about a kind of a rich farmer and a poor servant. And in telling the story, David gets angry at how this guy who had all the power treated this guy who had no power. And David got mad and he said, Prophet, tell me, who is this guy? Thank God for that preacher. I wouldn't have wanted to have been him, because he pointed to David and said, you're the guy. You're the man. That's the role of the Holy Spirit in your life and mine, to point to me and to point to you and say, you're the guy. You're the gal. There is this thing in your life that gets in the way of our relationship. You need to repent. Matthew 15:8, these people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. Matthew 5:8, the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus said, blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Purity of heart, Jesus says, every time over purity of decorations. You see, Jesus wasn't impressed with how good the Pharisees looked. In fact, Jesus called them whited sepulchers because they were full of dead men's bone. He said, you look real good on the outside, man, but there's nothing inside. You know, you knocked at the door and there was nobody home. That's what Jesus said about the Pharisees. I've been knocking at your door and nobody is home. Purity literally means unmixed, no bad ingredients thrown in. There was a game back in grade school that kids used to play some. This was about the time that electric blenders first came out. And what kids would do, they would raid their parents' pantries and find all kinds of food to mix in a blender, and they would all meet at whoever's house had the best blender. And so they would come with eggs and cottage cheese and peanut butter and ketchup and broccoli and mustard and anything else they could get their hands on, and they would all put it in a blender and mix it up. Probably created quite a mess sometimes. Well, one mom sat down with her kids who knew they were doing this, and she said, I want you to know I have no problem with this game you're playing, but there's two rules at this house if you play that game. Two rules. Number one, everything you put in the blender must be edible. In other words, no dirt, no socks, nothing metal. The son said shaving cream was kind of a gray area. Wasn't sure where that one fit in. And she said the other rule was everybody who participated, everybody who brought something to put in it, all had to have one teaspoon bite of what they'd made. Had to be edible. You had to taste it. That was a very wise mama, because that game quickly lost its appeal in their neighborhood. The results looked and smelled awful, and the taste was even worse. And sometimes I wonder if our hearts resemble that game. It's certainly not pure and unmixed. What ingredients have you poured into the blender of your soul? What things are you trying to mix in with the fruit of the Spirit and live your life? The New Testament tells us a lot about what kind of things we should be putting inside of us. For example, Paul gives us a great summary in Philippians chapter 4, verse 8, when he says, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. When was the last time that you hit your knees and you confessed your sins before God? I mean all of them. Not the ones you've even hidden from yourself, but I mean all of them. I mean the last time you did it, not because you got caught, or not because you were in trouble and hoped God might take it easy on you if you confessed it finally. But I mean you hit your knees and confessed your sin because you love God. Because you realize that what you have done is not good for the love relationship between you and God. In theology, we talk about two kinds of sins. Sins of commission and sins of omission. Sins of commission are doing something wrong. That's action. Sins of omission is the failure to act, the failure to do what is right. This really has a lot to do with attitude. You see, by confessing our sins, what we actually do is we come to that moment where we finally empty out our hearts and we prepare ourselves for the cleansing that Jesus Christ offers. We finally come to the end of ourselves. And it's only at the end of ourselves do we find the all-absolute sufficiency of Jesus Christ for everything that we face in life. It is there that we find the forgiveness for our own sin. It is there that we find the sufficiency to forgive others for how they have hurt us. It is there that we find the strength to go on when we have no strength. It is there that we find comfort when our heart is grieved and bereaved. It is there that we replace our anger with affection. It is there that we take our despair and we find hope. Only at the end of ourselves. Coming to the end of me means I am not worried about performing for others anymore. It means I'm no longer interested in just faking it for the folks at church. This is the message that John the Baptist preached, repentance and salvation. Imagine the excitement and the relief of those folks who poured out of the city streets of Jerusalem and came out to the desert to hear this message. They had been burdened for decades, for centuries, under the burden of religion. You must do this and this and this and this, and then that's still not enough. And John the Baptist says, come and confess. Be relieved of your sin and your guilt. Can you not imagine why they didn't want to go back to the city and share with their relatives and friends and neighbors this great new message and truth they'd heard? See, I can't imagine the burdensomeness of the Muslim faith. If you want a shot at heaven and a handful of virgins, go kill a bunch of people and die in the process. And maybe, no guarantee, you'll even get what you were promised. Judaism was just as oppressive in that day. Jesus and John comes along and says, confess your sin, find the forgiveness of God, let Jesus come live within your life. That's our responsibility. That's our privilege today as disciples of Christ, is to continue that work of John the Baptist. We're commissioned by Jesus to go into the world and prepare the way for Christmas. We are to go into the world and share this gospel to proclaim the good news of salvation. And some of y'all are saying, Tim, that's your job. And you are absolutely right. But guess what? It's your job. And I'm absolutely right. It is our job to do it. Christmas is a special time. It's a time when our hearts are open for the reception of Jesus Christ. Old grudges often get set aside at Christmas. Hardened hearts are softened. Old wounds are healed. Joy replaces bitterness. People begin to think of others rather than themselves. And this is where we find the true joy of Christmas. Shelley and I started the first year we got married. We started a little tradition between Thanksgiving and Christmas, and that is we try to watch two new Hallmark Christmas movies every week from Thanksgiving to Christmas. Sometimes TiVo makes it great. She can record one and we can see it at a time when we're both available. And man, you know what I find about all the Christmas movies? Really, almost without exception, every Christmas movie has the message of Christ in it somewhere, somehow. Almost all of them. And it occurred to me the other night as I was watching one, it seems like that the Hallmark Channel does a better job than the church sharing the good news of Christmas. And isn't that sad? The Den Hartogs had David Dunlap carve out of wood a gigantic, very simple nativity scene out of wood. It's like 12 feet wide and 15 feet tall. Okay, I might have exaggerated just a bit, but not by much. It's on the top of their barn that faces Knees Avenue. It's one that he had made for us. Actually, we had it in the church, I think, two Christmases ago, and we have a small one that hangs on our fence near our barn. But this one is gigantic, and I stopped by the other night after I knew it got hung that day, and they were finishing touches, getting lights on, so I helped them with that a little bit. And I said, well, why did you want to do this on the end of your barn this big? And here was Joan's answer. She said, I wanted to make a statement for Christmas. Make a statement for Christmas. Inside this barn, Jesus is Lord. How about another statement? And you can't use a symbol. You're going to have to use some words. How about inside this life, Jesus lives. We have a responsibility to prepare the way, to be the voice crying in the wilderness. It's our privilege to proclaim Jesus Christ. The message today really is very simple. Prepare our hearts. By repentance, receive cleansing in order to be ready to go out and prepare the way for others to receive Him. Let me close with a story. Lee was a reporter for the Chicago Tribune. A self-professed atheist was sitting at his desk on Christmas Eve. It was a slow news day, and he found himself reminiscing about the Delgado family, who he had written an article, one of a series of articles about Chicago's neediest people just a few days earlier. The Delgado's family was comprised of a grandmother named Perfecta and her two granddaughters, Jenny, age 13, and her sister, Lydia, 11. He remembered how unprepared he was when he walked into that two-room apartment on the west side of Chicago for the interview. Bare halls and bare walls, no furniture, no rugs, nothing but a kitchen table, a handful of rice in the cupboards. He learned from that interview that Jenny and Lydia only had one short sleeve dress apiece, plus a thin gray sweater that they shared. On cold days, when the girls walked a half mile to school, one would start off with a sweater on at the halfway point. She would give it to her sister. It was all they had. Perfecta, as grandma, wanted more for her granddaughters and would have worked, but her age and her rheumatoid arthritis prevented her from working. Since this was a slow news day, Lee decided to check a car out of the carpool and drive to Chicago's west side to check on the Delgado family. When Jenny opened the door, he couldn't believe what he saw. His article on the Delgados had touched the hearts of many subscribers who responded with furniture and appliances, rugs, dozens of coats, scarves, gloves. The girls wouldn't have to share one sweater anymore. There were cartons and cartons of boxes of food everywhere. They had so much food that the cupboards and closets couldn't contain it. Someone had even donated a Christmas tree and under it mounds of presents, and they had on an envelope thousands of dollars in cash. Lee was astonished. But what astonished him most was what he found Perfecta and her granddaughters doing. They were preparing to give most of what they had received away. Why would you give so much of this away? Lee asked. Perfector responded, our neighbors are still in need. We cannot have all of this and them still have nothing. This is what Jesus would want us to do. He paused just a moment. If Jesus lives in you and he doesn't live in your neighbor's heart, do you want to be Lee or do you want to be Perfecta? After regaining his composure, he asked Perfecta another question. He wanted to know what she and the girls thought about the generosity that was shown to them. But again, Lee was not prepared for the answer. Perfecta said, this is wonderful. This is very good. We did nothing to deserve this. It is all a gift that comes from God. But, this is not his greatest gift. No, Lee, tomorrow we celebrate the birth of Jesus. He is our greatest gift. Lee was speechless as he drove back to his office. In the quiet of his car, he noted a couple of observations. He had plenty, and along with the plenty he had plenty of anxiety. While the Degados, despite their poverty, had peace. Lee had everything, and yet he still wanted more. But the Delgados had nothing, and yet they knew generosity. Lee had everything, and his life was as bare as the Delgados' apartment prior to the article being run. And yet the Delgados, who had nothing, were filled with hope, contentment, and spiritual certainty. Even though Lee had so much more than the Delgados, he longed for what they had in their poverty. Any of you ready to be Perfecta this Christmas? She's the heroine. She's the heroine of this story. The only way I know to be Perfecta is to repent. Anybody need to repent? Let's pray. Our Father, you called John the Baptist for a specific purpose. And once we have become your child, once we have been forgiven of our sin, and you come to live within us, you call us to the very same purpose for which John the Baptist was called. We have just a few weeks before the day that's been set aside to remember the birth of Jesus. May none of us be ashamed or bashful or engaged in the secret service of your army. But Father, may we be vocal in our kindness. May we be loud with our generosity. May we be open about our faith. But first, expose to us our need to repent. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Have a great day.